You're enduring and getting through this, and not only that, but you're cracking some heads open with the information you're bringing to the table, especially the blue flu stuff and the blue plague. And it is, I know I'm glad you're doing it. I know a lot of other people are glad you're doing it, and we all hope that you continue to do it and stay as protected and safe as possible for all of us.
Well, see, the motivation, it's pure as far as I'm concerned. Look, I don't have any ads on my site. We don't share on YouTube with the Google cashback or anything. We refuse it. If we're forced to have ads, I'm taking everything off and we'll put it up privately somewhere else. That's my attitude about it. Is, look, I like some others, and this is sad, but there are some that were involved with supposedly getting the truth out about the Gulf, where all of a sudden they disappeared, and it wasn't because of good people like Kindra Arneson or Pensacola Gregg. I mean, they were genuinely into it, but there are others out there that were into it for money, and I know it, and you know it, and lots of others know it. And all of a sudden they disappeared. They're not heard from anymore. Or their agenda, you can see on what they're posting, it's all on a specific agenda. And I won't do that. And I think that I'm here for one purpose and one purpose only, about the Gulf specifically, and that is, I don't care what it is that I find, how bad the truth might sound. Of course, this last article and video, plenty bad enough for me, but they're screwing around with Mother Nature, and nobody knows the repercussions. And if somebody doesn't warn, who is? So I'll do it as long as I can do it. And I don't want money for it. I'm not looking for hits for Google Ads. I don't have ads on my site. Nobody gets pop-ups. That's just the way I am. And there's my motivation. And Liz, my co-host, and she's more than producer. I mean, I just can't get all this stuff together without help. And she's the same way. We just refuse. We're not going to parlay the money game.
Well, good. Because I think really for you, you're dealing with such a sensitive subject. You're talking about the livelihood of an economy and ecology and people and all that stuff. And the money game, when it gets into stuff like that, can be pretty tricky. So I congratulate you on keeping your attention in the right place.
Well, that's to keep independent. In other words, nobody owns me because they're paying me. And that's the only way that I can approach this. And it's the only way that I know that I'll get the truth out, whether it's what some particular group likes or not. That's the way it has to be if you're going to do it right. And I'm trying to absolutely do it right. It's kind of scary what's going on in the Gulf, but I love your perspective about things. I know you've thought about this, and you've read or seen what I've put up lately with this synthetic weird stuff, to go eat up oil and what they call bioremediation. That's some scary stuff, Robert. I mean, really scary stuff, because nobody knows what kind of effect it's going to have. Why do you think, you've got different insights than I do, so I'm really going to try to pull this out of you. Why do you think we're at this point? Now you look at astrology, where I know nothing about it. What are you putting together with all this? What, I know one thing, and then I'll shut up and let you talk. One thing for sure, we are at a turning point. There's no doubt about it. It's a physical, but more so a spiritual turning point. And that's right the baseline. That's what I'm saying that this is about. Now, how are you viewing what we're going through and what's due to come down the road?
Well, my sense is that we are we're really at the cusp of one, level and order of history and being, and another. I mean, we are. It's not just the Gulf. I mean, we're looking at you know, staggering amounts of debts that have been accrued via interest-based and fiat lending throughout the world, and you know, toxic debt and trading a toxic debt. You know, really, sort of like the metaphor of trading toxic debt is selling organs on the organ market with cancerous cells in them, and knowing, giving those organs to people, knowing they're infected with cancerous cells. I mean, that's really the metaphor for toxic debt. People were trading on securities that were going to just go bad, and making money off, and they're still making money off, or they're making off money off the recovery of that now.
Oh,
so
yeah.
that's one level of you know, what we're talking about. The other level, obviously, is this insidious biological level and surreality that's taking place in the Gulf of Mexico. And then there are other levels as well. I mean, you've got the whole disclosure thing, theoretically, which might be taking place. So, you know, what we're looking at is a kind of a concrescence of events, both real and simulated, to bring about a level of chaos on the planet. So, you know, chaos is kind of an interesting thing. You know, what do you do with it? You know, it's going to be there regardless of, you know, nature has its own chaotic processes. And now we're dealing with unnatural chaotic processes, which are artificial and inflicted. So chaos is really, I mean, if you look at astrology, you know, we look at really the juncture between Uranus and Pisces and moving into Uranus and Aries. And right now we're at the tail end of Uranus and Pisces. So we're talking about kind of the end in some ways of a level of the Piscean age, and moving into Uranus and Aries, which is a very different energy. And that takes place in January, later January of 2011. And that really is the start of what really could be the inception of things like the Fourth Reich and the rise of fascism, and the implementation of synthetic systems. Because if you look at...
Really?
Yeah. If you look at what happened in the 30s, from 1920, I believe it was from 1926 or 27 to 1934, Uranus was in Aries. And during that time, you have the greatest amount of technological breakthrough in any epoch of history since probably... what took place in the Fertile Crescent in Mesopotamia, Sumeria, with the inception of metallurgy and farming and agriculture and astronomy, literally happening overnight. Well, the same thing happens in 1927 to about 1933, when Uranus was last in Aries. And during that time, you had the discovery of the jet engine, the computer, radar, sonar, television, plastics, synthetics, all this stuff takes place during that time period. And then, of course, once they have all this really cool stuff that they've whipped up and created, well, they've got to do something with it. And then the next iteration of that is to go test it out in the theater of war. So that's what happens in World War II, is they get to road test all this stuff that they've been working on from the late 20s up into the early 30s. Well, we're getting ready to go back into that phase again, and we're going to be in that phase in January, and it lasts roughly about 9.5 to 10 years. And what we'll see during that period of time is there's a couple things that are going to be taking place, because things are cyclical and they're not cyclical, right? Like during that time when all those inventions were taking place and going on behind closed doors, right? Humanity was really kind of asleep. You know, it was, we were in a very different place in terms of our consciousness. And in some ways we were better, in some ways we weren't. But now we're at a point where we're waking up, and Uranus and Aries has as much impact on the individual as it does on the collective, or the powers that be, or the military-industrial complex, or corporations. Uranus and Aries is all about the self. It's all about the individual, and Uranus is like a lightning bolt. So You know, what we're really kind of, I think, on a it's a race against the clock in some ways. It's, you know, can we get enough people to wake up in time, really? And waking up is a really subjective piece. And it could be just looking at the world differently, to actually doing something about what you see in the world differently. Can we get enough people to wake up in time before the implementation of the singularity? And the singularity is when artificial intelligence officially surpasses organic intelligence. And I think when the singularity kicks in, what we're really looking at, Michael, is a kind of a Borgian, a Terminator-like society. And certainly we can see that in much of the art and the media that we're seeing right now. I mean, I have a kid. I've got a six-year-old kid. I watch cartoons with him. Every other cartoon is about something becoming a robot, something transforming into a robot, robotic consciousness. Now, let's bring this back to what's going on in the Gulf of Mexico. And your ability to really dig in and find out, you know, what this stuff is doing to people's insides. You know, this is a carbon-eating agent that you've uncovered.
Yeah. Okay? Totally synthetic, lab made, like the Borg.
Yep. So guess what? Now, let's say, for instance, this goes viral. Let's just say it's a nightmare, it goes viral, and people are having to deal with it.
Well, Cliff High seems to think so, right?
So what would be, if it was a carbon-eating enzyme, what do you think would be the solution for carbon-eating enzymes?
That's a good question that I've never even thought of. I'm just freaked out enough that it's there.
Well, the solution would be to replace carbon with silicon.
I get your point.
Because at that point, the virus wouldn't be able to eat anything anymore. It would literally not recognize the substance. So one of the things, I'm in the realm of projection and speculation, but based on kind of where we're headed with this Uranus-Aries and what you've uncovered here and the convergence, the singularity, what I could see come out of this is some form of synthetic gene replacement therapy.
That'll end up with us.
Exactly. And if you want to get through this, you want to live, you're gonna have to embrace something which may change the nature of your being, which is human. Now, look, I'm going to tell you right now that's already out there. I mean, it's in the wind. It is in chemtrails. There are polymers in chemtrails. There are nano arrays in chemtrails. There are viruses in chemtrails. This is how they get all that stuff into our system. It's in gene manipulation. Most of us right now don't even know it, but we're walking around as synthetic and actually augmented beings right now.
That's true.
I'm likely one of them. We are.
That's true.
And so the next phase of this would be a more, sort of generalized application solution-based system where, okay, you know what, here, take this, and what will happen is it'll have an interesting interstitial relationship between your DNA, and it will be a silicon fortification. They may even couch it as a supplement of some sort, a silicon supplement.
Or possibly a vaccine coming from the same genetic labs that create these artificial life forms that, we've got the vaccine.
Right, exactly.
The same companies are involved. They just started that company on October 7th. Synthetic Genomics is in partnership with BP, and I'm sure that this bioremediation with the synthetic genomes is their making. And all of a sudden, just a couple of weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, they're announcing a new company called Synthetic Genomics Vaccines. How convenient.
Wow. That's amazing.